हेलो फ्रेंड्स, सो इन दिस वी विल लर्न अबाउट द निमोनियास. सो व्हाई इज देयर अ निमोनिया? व्हाट इज निमोनिया? निमोनिया इज कॉल्ड इज कंसोलिडेशन ऑफ एल्वियोलाई और इन्फिल्ट्रेशन ऑफ इंटरस्टिशियल टिश्यू विथ इन्फ्लेमेटरी सेल्स. सो देर आर मेनली, इफ यू सी इन द निमोनिया, वी हैव टू मेजर सॉरी We have two major types of pneumonia. We have two major types of pneumonia. So what are the two different types of pneumonia that we have? So the two major types of pneumonia include, we have the lobar pneumonia. Two types of pneumonia are called as lobar pneumonia and bronchopneumonia. Okay. So if you see, this is bronchopneumonia, this is lobar pneumonia. See, here the lobes are involved, here the bronchi are involved. If the lobes are involved, that is lobar pneumonia. If the bronchi, you know, these are bronchi, right? If these bronchi are involved, then that is bronchopneumonia. So we have two major types of pneumonia. Then you can also divide it as community acquired pneumonia, which we get from the community, or hospital acquired pneumonia, which one gets from the hospital. This hospital by admission from the hospital, this hospital acquired pneumonia can be divided again into two types. One, we have healthcare associated pneumonia, that is, it can be due to chronic dialysis or, you know, admitting into a hospital for a few days. Then if one gets this pneumonia symptoms, then we call it as healthcare associated pneumonia. Second, we also have something called as ventilator associated pneumonia, the pneumonia that we one gets due to ventilator usage. Okay, so these are the different classification of pneumonia. Then once you have learned about the classification of pneumonia, first we will see each of them. Okay, the pictures I will tell, I'll first explain you all the pictures, and then we go to the theoretical aspect of it. So if you see, this is the lobar pneumonia in the right lobe. See, here all this is the pneumonic tissue. Okay, so this is the consolidated. See here, instead of here, see, you can clearly demarcate it. So this is pink in color, right? So this pink in color, whichever you are seeing, all this is actually normal. But see here, here, is it normal? No, it's not pink, right? It is some different type of, you know, consolidation. So that is consolidation. Okay, next. The same thing, if you see the similar picture, if you see in the chest x-ray, in chest x-ray you can see this consolidation which you are seeing. So this is again pneumonia. Okay, the similar picture, comparing both. So here, what is this? This is the picture with sputum. These are the cells in the sputum. And where are gram positive cocci? Remember, these are not cocci. Okay, but what are cocci then? Here the cocci are these. See, if you see, you have two. Similarly, if you just scroll it, see this two, these two, here. So these are cocci, these are the epithelial cells. Okay, so you can see gram positive diplococci most commonly. What is gram positive diplococci? That is pneumococci, which is nothing but streptococcus pneumonia infection. Okay, so this is first picture. Next, the next picture shows you the pathological changes which occur. See, I have told you that we have two types of pneumonia. One, we have lobar pneumonia. Second, we have bronchopneumonia. So in the lobar pneumonia, here the bronchi are not affected. Mainly the lobes of the lung are the things which are mainly affected. So if you do a chest x-ray, I have shown you that there will be consolidation, right? I'll show you again. So this is the consolidation which you see. And if you see the bronchi are completely normal here. See this side, see, there is bronchi and everything is normal. There is no other, you know, bronchial inflammation is not seen. Okay, you will only see the lobar consolidation. Most commonly, this lobar pneumonia, the most common cause of lobar pneumonia is same. I have already told you, it is streptococcus pneumonia. This lobar pneumonia is also called as round pneumonia also. The lobar pneumonia due to streptococcus is called as round pneumonia. Okay, lobar pneumonia is not just caused by streptococcus, it is also caused by Klebsiella pneumonia. Okay, before going into the etiological agents in detail, first and foremost, we will classify lobar pneumonia pathogenetically. Lobar pneumonia, 90% of lobar pneumonia cases are mainly caused by pneumococcus, as I have already said. They are also caused by Klebsiella, Pseudomonas, Proteus, Staphylococci or E. coli. Now, what is the morphology? Morphologically, you can see that there are four different stages that occur in lobar pneumonia. One, the first stage is called as edema stage or initial congestion. Stage of initial congestion. So, in this is the initial and first stage. This stage takes in this stage the lung will be present for 1 to 2 days. You will see the lung being in this stage for 1 to 2 days. So, in this stage, you see that the alveoli here, so this is the alveoli, right? It is filled with just fluid containing pneumococci. That's it. There will be some neutrophils, okay? There will be some bacteria, and you will not see anything else, okay? You will see serous discharge. So, here obviously it is filled with something, right? So, it is filled with an edematous fluid which contains the few RBCs, neutrophils and bacteria, mainly the bacteria. Second, you can tell the second stage is the stage of early consolidation, or there is one more name for this stage. This is also called as stage of red hepatinization. This is called as red hepatization. Why do you call it as red hepatinization? Because in this stage, gross appearance of lung is somewhat like liver consistency. That is the reason why we call it as red hepatinization. Here, this red hepatinization will occur in 2 to 4 days. So, this occurs in 2 to 4 days. So, what do you see in this red hepatinization? The main thing is you will see, obviously you will see polymorphonuclear. So, these are the, these are the white blood cells which you see. I will just zoom in so that you can see it properly, even more properly. See, what are these? These are the white blood cells, okay? See, you can even see them now. See, these are the white blood cells which you can see, okay? And you can also see, what are these? These are the RBCs which you can see. Okay, these are the RBCs which you are seeing here, right? And these which you are seeing here, what are these? These are the diplococci, two cocci. You can see here clearly. If you just zoom in at this, you will see two diplococci. Okay, so what are you seeing in this phase of early consolidation? In this stage of early consolidation, you see red blood cells, you are seeing even the WBCs, and you can see even the bacteria. Okay, that is stage of red hepatization or early consolidation. In this stage, grossly you will see it has liver like consistency or firm red color. Okay, then the next is zone of advanced consolidation, or you can also call this as the zone of gray hepatization. What is this? This is zone of gray hepatization. Okay, so what are you going to see in this zone of, actually it occurs from 4 to 8 days, and what are you going to see in this zone of gray hepatization? See, in this zone of, what are you going to see in this zone of gray hepatization? You see there will be intense WBCs, okay, and the pneumococci are destroyed, and you will see all the white blood, red blood cells are actually reabsorbed or engulfed by the macrophages, and as a result here you see you don't see any RBCs. So I'm zooming it in, you are not seeing any RBCs. What are you actually seeing here? You are just seeing the WBCs. This is WBCs, okay, neutrophils. Are you seeing any bacteria? See, If you scroll down, you will see no bacteria. See here, you can see these are the bacteria, right? Here you can clearly see the bacteria. These are the bacteria which you can see. See here, okay? But here, are you seeing any bacteria? Here you are not seeing any bacteria. Right, 1 minute. Yeah. Okay, here you won't see any bacteria. So here you mainly see polymorpho nuclear neutrophils and no bacteria. Okay, then the last zone, which is called as zone of resolution. This zone of resolution goes on from 8th to 9th day. Okay, what are you going to see in this? In this, you will see fibrous tissues that are seen. So here you will see the fibrosis starts to occur. Okay, so if you can see here. Just see, here you will see the fibrosis. All the WBCs are also decreased now in number, and you will see the fibrosis starts sets in, and here the complete solid thing which you have seen before, that has been liquefied by enzymatic action. Okay, now in this resolution stage, all the macrophages will now replace the leukocytes which were there, and these macrophages will engulf all the neutrophils, debris, and some of the digested fibrin material, all that. And this is the stage of resolution, which is from 8th to 9th day. Okay, so this is important. Next, this stage can further go into complication stage of complications. In this stage, the patient infection becomes, the infection of pneumococci becomes disseminated, and the patient suffers from endocarditis, empyema, paraneumonic sterile pleural effusion, purulent pericarditis, or intravascular coagulopathy in asplenic patients. Next, we will see the bronchopneumonia. See, this is mycoplasma. Okay, mycoplasma is one of the organism in lobar pneumonia. It is actually an organism causing interstitial pneumonia. Okay, this mycoplasma is an organism which is most commonly causing interstitial pneumonia. So what is interstitial pneumonia? Interstitial pneumonia is, it is not involving the lobes, it is not involving the bronchi, but it is involving the interstitial material present between the alveoli. See, if these are the alveoli, if the inflammation is involving these lobes, these alveoli, then we call it as lobar pneumonia. If the infection is involving the bronchi, okay, then we call it as bronchopneumonia. But if this infection is involving, if this infection is involving the bronchi, then we call it as bronchopneumonia. Think that if this infection is actually involving the interstitial spaces, not the alveoli, these are called as interstitial pneumonia. Okay, these are called as interstitial pneumonia. So mycoplasma pneumonia is a type of interstitial pneumonia. And where do you see here the fever type in mycoplasma pneumonia is actually, it is increasing and then decreasing. Okay, which you see here. And the patient also suffers from headache, malaise, cough, and rales. Okay, all this is not necessary, it is present in almost all mycoplasma pneumonia, all pneumonias. Okay, the important thing is this appearance of mycoplasma. What is this appearance called as? This is like fried egg. So this is typical fried egg appearance is seen in this type of mycoplasma pneumonia. And then you can do cold agglutination test is done for mycoplasma pneumonia, where you see the positive test is like this, and this is the control. Now, what are the complications? In the complications, it can cause bullous meningitis, or it can cause transverse myelitis, or you can see it can cause cold agglutination hemolytic anemia, or myocarditis. These are the different complications which are associated with mycoplasma. Next, Next, the next organism, we will see each and every organism. Okay, just a brief explanation. So the next organism is Chlamydophila sittaci pneumonia. So what are you going to see in this Chlamydophila? In the Chlamydophila, obviously you will have pneumonia, and that is Chlamydophila sittaci. This is the capsulated organism. It is most commonly from the pigeons, and this is the electron microscopic picture which you see the capsule and the nucleus of this Chlamydophila sittaci pneumonia. And here the features are normal features like any other type of pneumonia, but the predominant are, there is the differentiating is rash, presence of rash and splenomegaly. The complications are, there can be encephalitis, hepatitis, or there can be kidney failure, or there can be hemolytic anemia. The next organism is Legionella pneumonia. This Legionella pneumonia, if you see, there is small blunt pleomorphic intracellular and extracellular bacilli are seen in this Legionella pneumonia. Okay, so these are the bacilli, these are both extracellularly seen and these are intracellularly also seen. Then if you do a chest radiograph, see, this is the consolidation which you see. With the help of chest radiograph, you can say that whether it is a lobar pneumonia or broncho pneumonia or interstitial pneumonia, but you cannot differentiate the causative organism. So this is definitely a lobar pneumonia which is involving the left lower lobe. Okay, next if you see, these are the, so this is histological section of the lung where you see the Legionella bacteria which you see. So this is Legionnaire's disease with many large macrophages. See, these are the Legionella organisms. See, these dots are Legionella organisms. Even here you can see similar dots here. Okay, these are Legionella species. So this is species specific fluorescent antibody. If you do, you will see this Legionella species. Then the next thing is staphylococcal pneumonia. So one important characteristic feature of staphylococcal pneumonia is presence of nematocells, multiple nematocells or bullae formation. See, these are the cavity like lesions which you are seeing. These are the multiple nematocells or the bulla formation. Okay, this is most common complication. This staphylococcal aureus pneumonia most commonly occurs as a complication of measles or influenza virus. Okay, so this is the picture which you see in staphylococcal pneumonia, where you see this is early staphylococcal pneumonia, and late you can see the cavity which has developed. There is abscess, there is pneumothorax. Okay, it is a little complicated. Now this picture shows many staphylococci organisms which are seen in Gram stain. Okay, so this is staphylococcal pneumonia. The next organism is again Haemophilus influenza. Okay, this is Haemophilus influenza. In this Haemophilus influenza, you can again see the bacteria here. These small dots are bacteria. These are the fussy cells, remember that. And here you see this lobar consolidation. And this Haemophilus pneumonia, influenza, you see it is most common in 3 months to 3 years of age. Okay, it is less common below 3 months of age because there is appearance of transplacental antibodies in the fetus which will protect the baby from this Haemophilus influenza pneumonia. Okay, so here this Haemophilus influenza also causes a complication which is called as epiglottitis. Then this is the next thing, which is Klebsiella pneumonia. This shows Klebsiella pneumonia. Okay, in this Klebsiella pneumonia, you can see the organisms here which are bacilli. Okay, these are the Klebsiella pneumonia Gram staining. Okay, and here you can see this is a consolidation which is seen. Klebsiella pneumonia is a consolidation which is seen in the right upper lobe. Okay, this Klebsiella pneumonia is also called as Friedlander's bacilli, and this is most commonly seen in the upper lobe, that too in the posterior segment of upper lobe. There is a sign which is seen here which is called as bulging fissure sign. Okay, this is bulging fissure sign, which you see. See, you can differentiate. This is the normal tissue. This is the consolidation part. So this is called as bulging fissure sign. Okay, this Klebsiella pneumonia has more complications like abscess formation, empyema, cavitations. Okay, all these are more common. Here there is mainly currant jelly sputum. Okay, red currant jelly sputum is seen in Klebsiella pneumonia, something like this. And here there is increased chances of abscess formation or pleural effusion, pleuritis, empyema, and even cavitation. So if you see, this is the pneumonia which involves the right upper lobe. Okay, consolidation is seen. Next we have influenza virus. This influenza viruses causes interstitial pneumonia mainly. Okay, so this is the electron microscopic picture of influenza virus. If you make it, you know, if you actually magnify it, this is the electron microscopic picture of influenza influenza virus. Okay, the virus gets invaginated, it penetrates into the cell cytoplasm. Okay, this is the influenza virus which contains hemagglutinin spikes and neuraminidase spikes. There is double lipid layer of virus capsule and there is protein layer also. There are RNAs and polypeptides are also seen. Okay, so all this is not necessary here. Now, what is important is this one. This mainly causes interstitial pneumonia. See, here these are the interstitial cells which are involved. So it causes interstitial pneumonia where there is congestion of, see, you can see there is marked congestion of bronchial mucosa. Okay, and if you see, this is the picture where you can see the edema and there is cellular infiltrates and the capillaries are engorged. Alveoli are filled with fibrin containing material. See, remember, you can't see viruses in a HND stain, right? So these viruses are not visible here, only you will see cellular infiltrate only. So this is the picture which you are seeing here. These are the radiographs. These pictures are mainly taken from Netter's atlas. Okay, so this is lung tissue showing hyaline membrane. Next, this is chickenpox. Chickenpox also causes something called as varicella pneumonia. Even this shows nodular infiltrates are seen here. Okay, then histology, you will not see any bacteria, any viruses. You will just see the alveoli which is filled with fibrin, exudates and everything. Even here, see, this is the alveoli. The alveoli is lost actually. And you see these are the fibrin materials which are seen. And in between you can see the cells which are nothing but the mononuclear infiltrate. See, this is again the magnified view. In this magnified view, you can see multinucleate Giant cell. This is multinucleate Giant cell, which is characteristic of varicella pneumonia. These are the hemorrhagic pox which are seen in varicella pneumonia. Next, the next virus is cytomegalovirus. Okay, there is cytomegalovirus pneumonia. Here also you see only the fibrinous exudate in the interstitium, and main important thing in case inclusion bearing cell. So this is one inclusion bearing cell, this is inclusion bearing cell. See, these are inclusion bearing cells, this is one more. Okay, these are the inclusion bearing cells which are seen in cytomegalovirus. You can see here clearly, this is the inclusion body seen in cytomegalovirus. Okay, inclusion body and cytomegaly which is seen here. And if you see here in the immunofluorescent technique, the cells infected with cytomegalovirus are stained well. This is HeLa cells. Okay, HeLa cells with cytomegalovirus is something like this. Cytopathological effect which is seen in cytomegalovirus is enlargement and ulci vacuolation which is seen. Okay, next, this is severe respiratory, the acute respiratory distress syndrome, which is SARS. It is, okay, here you see the patient have headache, fever, malaise, you can see hypoxemia, decreased liver function test, decreased WBC count, all these are seen. See, this is coronavirus. In this, what are you going to see? In this, in the lung, you see diffuse alveolar infiltrate with macrophages, and you will also see multinucleated syncytial cells. So this is one multinucleated syncytial cell which is seen here. Okay, the next term. So this is, what is this? This is lung abscess. This picture shows the picture of abscess. So this is the abscess, well formed abscess, look at it. There is pus also, okay. Now if you see here, see, this is the abscess, this is the abscess which you are seeing here, and you are even seeing this fluid level, air fluid level is also seen in this abscess. So this is fluid and this is air, right? So this is right upper lobe mass, which is air fluid level, and thick wall is seen. And here this is the abscess cavity. Next, even here this is a CT scan which shows this is the lung, and here this is the air fluid level which is seen, and this is the abscess. This hole is the abscess which you see, okay. Next. Okay, these are the multiple abscess which you are seeing here. So here you have in the right lung, see, this is the abscess which is seen. So the left lung is less commonly affected, and here superior and posterior basal segments are mostly affected. Even here the upper and superior segments are mostly affected in the lower lobes. Anyways, so if you see, these are the multiple abscesses which occur due to septic embolization. This is a carcinoma, and because of obstruction there is again multiple abscesses which can occur. Then we have the, we are done with the normal pneumonia. Now there is hospital acquired pneumonia also. So what are the features of hospital acquired? First, what is the risk factors of hospital acquired pneumonia? Advancing age, chronic underlying disease like diabetes mellitus, hypertension, immunosuppression, obesity or malnutrition, altered level of consciousness, smoking, alcohol abuse and drug abuse. So all these are the risk factors of hospital acquired pneumonia. There are also treatment related factors, like whenever the patient is under parenteral nutrition or recent surgery, or if there is recent antibiotic exposure, or the risk factors like prolonged hospitalization, nursing home residence, or if there is chronic illness, recent hospitalization, or if there is prior antibiotics, hemodialysis, immunosuppression, or home infusion therapy for home wound care. So all these are the risk factors which will cause hospital acquired pneumonia. So how are you going to test it? So if you do a chest radiograph, you can see the consolidations are seen, and then you will have to undergo laboratory evaluation, where you will have to take sputum culture and also gram staining of this sputum, because I have shown you many images where the gram staining of a sputum showing various types of bacteria, right? And you can even do bronchoscopic evaluation. If the sputum is not, if the patient could not take his sputum out, then you can advise him to undergo bronchoalveolar lavage through bronchoscopy. Okay, now so what are the etiologies which are at risk of? So for example, if there is a case of splenectomy, okay, if in splenectomy case there is more increased chances or increased risk of pneumococcus, staphylococcal, Haemophilus influenza and Neisseria meningitis. And as a result, before splenectomy, every splenectomized patient or every patient who is planning for splenectomy should take vaccinations for Haemophilus influenza and pneumococci for sure. Then if there is chemotherapy induced neutropenia, in this case Pseudomonas aeruginosa is most commonly involved. If there is abnormal T cell function, in abnormal T cell function, mainly the bacteria like Listeria, monocytogenes, Salmonella, Legionella, Mycobacterium avium and Mycobacterium tuberculosis, or fungi like many fungi like Cryptococcus neoformans, Histoplasma capsulatum, Nemocystis jeruosi, Coccidioid simitis, or viruses like Cytomegalovirus, Herpes simplex, or parasites such as Toxoplasma gondii or Cryptosporidium, all these are involved. Now, what are the infections following organ transplantation? we have some nosocomial infections, okay, which occur after transplantation. So in the first month of life, most commonly, see, there are many infections. All these are the infections. It's not necessary to remember everything. Next, we will see some more organisms which are most commonly occurs in immunosuppression, like pneumocystis jerovesi. This pneumocystis jerovesi most commonly occurs in conditions where there is immunosuppression, like steroid therapy or transplantation. It also occurs in patients with heart transplantation, heart or bone marrow issues and kidney issues, or if the patient is suffering from HIV or leukemia or lymphoma. In these conditions where there is immunity of the patient is compromised, in those conditions pneumocystis jerovesi pneumonia develops. So if you see here, you can see bilateral pulmonary infiltrates which are seen in pneumocystis jerovesi. Even this is an interstitial pneumonia. Now you can also see these lymphocytes and plasma infiltration. This is the alveoli. In the alveoli you can see these foamy exudates are seen in the alveoli. You can see this interstitial pneumonia and filtration and foamy exudates. So pneumocystis jerovesi, this is the special stain which is called as silver staining, where you see these organisms showing cysts, and this is methanamine AgNO3 stain, where you can see these black spots. These black spots are pneumocystis jerovesi organism. Next, what is this? This is actinomycosis of jaw or lumpy jaw, which you are looking at the picture. So the actinomycosis causes abscesses of chest wall and with draining sinuses. So these are the abscesses of chest wall with draining sinuses. If you remember actinomycosis, you see something called a sunray appearance due to sulfur containing granules. So because these are the granules with sulfur, there is sunray appearance which is seen in actinomycosis shown in the figure. Then these are the two sulfured granules which are seen in the pus with petri dish. These are the sulfur granules. So this is about actinomycosis, the pictures. Then if you see, this is after actinomycosis, what is the next important organism? The next important organism after actinomycosis is nocardia. Okay, so this is nocardiosis, picture of nocardia showing histological and CT scan. So in this CT scan you can see this upper lobe consolidation with cavity. This is the nocardiasis, where you see consolidation and also cavity. See, these are the nocardia bacteria which you can see. So this is nocardiosis on Sabarod's glucose agar. These are also metic acid first stain. So here in this picture you see multiple abscesses. These are multiple abscesses with necrosis and pus formation. Okay, so this is what is seen in here. Okay, in nocardiosis you see multiple necrotic abscesses. Then if you see, nocardiasis can also cause brain abscess, and this is the picture showing acid fast bacilli. So these are the bacilli, acid fast organisms. Sorry, these are the acid fast organisms. I'm really sorry. These are the acid fast organisms which you see. These are the cells, pus cells. Okay, you can also see multiple nocardiasis abscess which are seen here in the kidney. Okay. Then after nocardiasis you have histoplasmosis. So this is the picture of showing histoplasmosis. So what are you seeing in histoplasmosis? In histoplasmosis you see this is an ulcerative lesion of histoplasmosis on the tongue. Now see this, in this picture you can see this is the histoplasmosis bacteria. See, this is fungi. So this is histoplasma capsulatum pores. Okay, so these are the histoplasma which are seen in tissues. So these are the histoplasma. This is a macrophage and these are the histoplasma which are seen in the macrophage. This is histoplasma in macrophage. Okay, next, Next, here you can see in coronal CT, you can see pulmonary nodules which are seen. Okay, why are these nodules seen? What is the causative organism, sir? For these nodules, this is also histoplasmosis is the causative organism. See, even here you can see at the level of carina, you can see bilateral hyalur and subcarinal lymphadenopathy. So these are the lymphadenopathy which you can see. Because of the presence of lymphadenopathy, this histoplasmosis is most commonly confused by tuberculosis. Okay, here in this window you can see this also, which is atelectasis of middle lobe. The whole middle lobe is lost, and there are hyalur lymphadenopathy also. Then we have, after histoplasmosis, we have the next organism, which is coccidioidomycosis. This is coccidioidomycosis, where you see here in the periphery you see groundless opacity, right? So this is seen with lobulated in the middle lobe. This is coccidioidomycosis. Okay, here you can see granuloma in the nasolabial fold. In coccidioidomycosis, it mainly occurs due to skin penetration. You see, whenever there is skin penetration, you see formation of spherules with endospores. Later, these endospores are discharged. These are discharged into sputum and pus, where they form the mycelia. Again, they form the septate hypha, and then forms arthropods. Okay. Now, this coccidioidomycosis can also cause meningitis, or it can occasionally go to bones and liver and spleen and cause multiple draining sinuses also. Then, after coccidioidomycosis, the next organism which can occur is blastomycosis. Blastomycosis can also cause pneumonia. Okay, if you see this blastomycosis, here you can see this consolidation. Okay, mass like consolidation in the middle lobe. Okay, so this is the granulomatous Jain cell which is showing organisms which are white colored. Are organisms, and these are the cells. Even here, these are the many macrophages with the cells and material. Then here in high power field you see budding and non-budding organisms. So this is in electron microscopy or organ in culture, you can see this. Then these are the skin lesions of blastomycosis. Then you have one more which is called as paracoccidioidomycosis. There's no need to remember everything. I'm just showing it because you know you might feel interested in seeing all this. Coccidioidomycosis. So in this coccidioidomycosis, you can see here the lesion which is seen on the lips, and here also you can see the organism. Okay, yeast cell, yeast phase cell with single buds and giant cells. So these are the yeast cells, and this is a giant cell, and this is the yeast phase which you can see. These are the colonies on blood agar which you are seeing. Paracoccidioidobrazilensis. These are on sabrodextrose agar, you can see like this. This is a test called as precipitin test, which is done for these patients. Then this is cryptococcosis. Cryptococcus pneumonia is most commonly seen in cryptococcus is most commonly causes meningitis also, pneumonia also. It is if you see, this is most commonly seen in immunocompromised or immunosuppressed individuals. Okay, so here you can see mediastinal lymph nodes also. So the main important thing is Indian ink preparation is common in Cryptococcus neoformans. Okay, these are the skin lesions which are seen in the foot and ankle due to cryptococcosis. Now, once after cryptococcosis, then you will have to see the aspergilloma. Already we have learnt about allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis in the last class. So in this class we will see a few points about aspergilloma. So So this is the film showing aspergilloma. So this is aspergilloma of the right lung. Okay. Then, I'm sorry. This is the chronic appearance of aspergilloma again, which is seen here. Here in this, you see opacity here. This is the opacity which you are seeing here, and here. These are the many aspergilloma which see tangled mass like hyphae. See, all these are hyphae which you can see. So this is the hyphae which shows spores, also microconidia are also seen. Okay, so this is Aspergillus niger. Then, okay, now let us see some pictures from robins. So this is the bacterial pneumonia picture, and it shows here, this shows pneumonia here. Okay, bacterial pneumonia. And this is pneumonia. These are lighter areas which are cut surfaces. Okay, this is the brighter infiltrate which you see here. Then this is again bacterial pneumonia, which shows gross appearance here, which is lobar pneumonia. See here, this is the upper lobe consolidation. Complete right upper lobe consolidation is seen here. Then here, this is bacterial pneumonia microscopically. Here alveoli are actually filled with neutrophilic infiltrate. You can see this properly here, where you can see neutrophilic infiltrate in the alveoli. See, this is the alveoli which is actually filled with neutrophilic infiltrate. See, again, this is the same picture again, showing alveoli with all neutrophilic infiltrates. This is the lung abscess gross picture which is showing this here. Okay, next. This is again the lung abscess. This is a lung abscess which is showing air fluid level also. This is the fluid, this is air. This is the CT scan which is again showing the air fluid level. Okay, then these are due to aspiration. Okay, these infiltrates are seen due to aspiration. Then this is empyema which shows gross structure where there is thick yellow tan purulent exudate is seen. This is empyema. Okay, now this is the picture of viral pneumonia where you cannot see the organisms. The mainly you see lymphocytic interstitial infiltrates are seen. See, if you see the difference in the picture, this is the alveoli. Remember properly, see properly, this is the alveoli. This is one minute. Just a minute, why is all this happening? Okay, so this is the alveoli. Okay, this is one more alveoli. This is alveoli. This is alveoli. So if you see, the alveoli are almost normal, or almost not normal, but still they are fine, right? The infiltration is present in between the alveoli in the interstitial spaces. Okay, the same thing we will compare it with the picture before. Just a minute. We will compare it with this picture. 1 minute. Okay, that is not going on. Fine. See, in this picture, if you see, not this one, I'm sorry. Yeah, in this picture, this is the alveoli, right? And where is the infiltrate actually present? It is present inside the alveoli. Okay? So if you just compare this with this picture, here where is the infiltration? It is present surrounding the alveoli mostly. So this is interstitial pneumonia, which is viral pneumonia. See, even here you can see some spaces are at least alveoli, right? And here respiratory syncytial virus, you can even see the giant cell, multinucleated giant cell in the respiratory syncytial virus. This is cytomegalovirus pneumonia, where you see owl's eye like inclusion bodies and basophilic stippling is seen. Okay, large violet colored intranuclear inclusion bodies are also seen. So this is the picture of histoplasmosis. I have already shown you histoplasmosis capsulatum. Okay, HND stain. Then this is the picture of blastomycosis. Okay, here this picture is gomori methanamine silver stain which is showing blastomycosis. So this is the cell with many, see, the all these are blastomycosis mycelial phase. Then this is coccidioidomycosis. You can see the endospore. with many spirules. This is one sperule with many endospores. These are many endospores which you see here. Okay, two sperules, see, small sperules which are seen here. Then this is cryptococcus. See, you can see numerous cryptococcus in the alveoli. And one more thing, on the right side here you can see Indian ink preparation of cryptococcus. Then this is again cryptococcus pneumonia which is seen. And this is mucic carmine stain, where the organism is highlighted here. This is mucic carmine stain. Staining is very important, you should remember all these. Okay, this is pneumocystis pneumonia, where you see this, what is this stain again? Gomori methanamine silver stain, which is done mainly for fungi. Then this is aspergilloma. You can see the aspergilloma here and targetoid lesion. Okay, so these are the mycelia which you can see. See, these are mycelia of aspergillus. Hello friends, welcome to a new topic today, and in this chapter we are going to learn, let us continue about pneumonia. Okay, pneumonia, so it is consolidation of alveoli or infiltration of interstitial tissue with inflammatory cells. So in this pneumonia, the pathological factors, so first we will see the protective factors which will prevent the pneumonia. Okay, so these are the protective factors which will prevent the occurrence of pneumonia. Like, for example, hair and turbinates of nares. We have in the anterior nares, we have hair and even turbinates. These air will capture the larger inhaled particles and they prevent from entering into the nasopharynx or larynx and all the other airways. Then we also have tracheobronchial tree. This tracheobronchial tree branches, see, trachea branches into two bronchi, right bronchi and left bronchi. Right bronchi is a little straighter one and shorter one, whereas left bronchi is curved. Actually, it is at an angle to the right bronchi, right? So because of this curvature, it will trap this. Tracheobronchial tree is again made up of ciliated columnar epithelium. It has cilia over the epithelium, and as a result, because of the cilia, it traps the particles. Okay, whenever there is some particle which enters the nasopharynx, because of the reflex action, gag reflex or cough reflex, this will prevent from aspiration. Okay, even in the oropharynx there are normal flora. These normal flora present in the mucosal cells of oropharynx will prevent the pathogenic bacteria or pathogenic fungi, pathogenic things to bind to it. And there is also resident alveolar macrophages which are present in the oropharynx or nasopharynx or in the respiratory epithelium, which will kill the pathogen whenever this binding has taken place. Then these macrophages also combine with the local proteins, and these local proteins with which the macrophages combine are called as opsonizing proteins or antiviral or antibacterial proteins. Okay, then the capacity of the macrophages to kill alveolar cells, alveolar macrophages, is less than that of pathogens. See, all the pathogens cannot be killed by alveolar macrophages. That is the only reason why we get this pneumonia illness. Or else, if all the bacteria, viruses and fungi are being killed by the alveolar macrophages efficiently, then there is no question of having this disease in our body, right? Because the alveolar macrophages are not capable of killing all the bacteria or viruses, maybe because of the bacterial load or maybe because of the virulence factors that the bacteria develops against these macrophages, there occurs pneumonia. And during pneumonia, what actually important here is these during pneumonia there will be a release of interleukin 1 and tumor necrosis factor which manifests as fever. During pneumonia there is also release of interleukin 8, granulocyte colony stimulating factor, and also creatinine kinase. Okay, and these during pneumonia these also release neutrophils. Macrophages and neutrophils are also released. Okay, all these will cause alveolar leak leading to acute respiratory distress syndrome. So we can classify pneumonia into two types. One, as I have already said, one is airspace pneumonia, second is interstitial pneumonia. So airspace pneumonia, in this the alveoli are mainly inflamed. So we have in the airspace pneumonia, we have two types. One, we have lobar pneumonia, second we have bronchopneumonia. In lobar pneumonia, bronchi are not affected. Chest x-ray shows air bronchogram or lobar consolidations. This is most commonly seen in streptococcus pneumonia. Whereas second, we have bronchopneumonia. In bronchopneumonia, bronchi are affected. And in bronchopneumonia, chest x-ray shows there is no air bronchogram or it shows patchy consolidation. The most common organism causing bronchopneumonia is staphylococcal aureus or staphylococcal pneumonia. So, I said lobar pneumonia. Lobar pneumonia is of two types. One, we have streptococcus pneumonia, or also called as round pneumonia, where the causative organism is streptococcus. Second type is Klebsiella pneumonia, or it is caused by Klebsiella pneumococci or Friedlander's bacilli. So this pneumonia, which is caused by Klebsiella, is called as Friedlander's pneumonia also. So, the differences between Streptococcus pneumonia and Klebsiella pneumonia is very important. Especially if you see the Streptococcus pneumonia. Okay, this Streptococcus pneumonia, this is Klebsiella pneumonia, right? This Streptococcus pneumonia is most common in the lower lobe, whereas Klebsiella pneumonia is most common in the posterior segment of right upper lobe. And here there is a sign called as bulging fissure sign. See, there is abscess formation, pleural effusion, empyema and cavitation. All these occur in Klebsiella pneumonia only. These are not seen in Streptococcus pneumonia. Abscess formation, pleural effusion, empyema and cavitation are common in Klebsiella pneumonia. Next, if you see lobar pneumonia. Now, lobar pneumonia, so in the lobar pneumonia, etiology is there will be pneumococcus. 90% it is caused by pneumococcus. Sometimes it is also caused by staphylococcal aureus, gram negative like Haemophilus influenza, Klebsiella, pneumococcus proteus or E. coli. So what is the morphology? The morphology include there is first stage of consolidation, stage of congestion is present, or initial phase, which is 1 to 2 days. Here you see enlarged heavy dark red and congested, and here you see neutrophils, bacteria and also some RBC. Then we have red hepatinization, or it is also called as early consolidation, which is seen in 2 to 4 days. Here there is liver like consistency or red film, and the edema fluid is replaced by fibrin exudate, neutrophils and RBCs. Then we have grey hepatinization, or also called as late consolidation, which is seen in 4 to 8 days. In these patients, the lungs are firm, heavy, greyish in color. And microscopically, you see fibrin strands which are dense and numerous. You can see cellular exudates of neutrophils. These cellular exudates of neutrophils are decreased due to disintegration of many inflammatory cells. Then we have resolution. In resolution, it is from 8th to 9th day, where you see solid constituent, fibrinous constituent is liquefied by enzymatic action. Softening begins centrally and spreads to the periphery. If you see microscopically, you see macrophages which engulfs the neutrophils and debris. Okay. So all this is important. I have already shown you all the pictures of these also. Then we have the next type of pneumonia, which is called as bronchopneumonia. What is seen in this bronchopneumonia? In this, there is infection of bronchiole, which is extending into the surrounding alveoli. The etiological features of bronchopneumonia include, it is most commonly due to streptococci, staphylococci, pneumococci, Klebsiella pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza. Among all these, staphylococcal aureus is most common. So if you see grossly, you see patchy areas of red gray consolidation are seen, and this consolidation affects one or more lobes. Okay, and this is bilaterally found, and it is most commonly found in lower zones of the lung. Okay, so what is the etiology? First, we'll see all the etiological factors and important features. So, first is pneumococci. Pneumococci is the most common cause of bacterial meningitis in adults and children. It is the most common cause of community-acquired pneumonia in adults and children. So pneumococci is the most common cause of bacterial meningitis and community acquired pneumonia in both adults and children. It is gram positive and it has diplococcal arrangement. In the microscope you see high graded pyrexia with purulent testis sputum. You see pleuritic chest pain. It pretense or associated with COPD. Okay, you see polymorphonuclear leukocytes are seen, and actually it is penicillin sensitive. So in order to prevent recurrence, we have polysaccharide pneumococcal vaccine, or we also have conjugated vaccine. Conjugate vaccine is approved for those who are more than 50 years and less than 2 years also. Then what is the indication of vaccines? This is very important. Indication of vaccine is age more than 6 years. And if there are any risk factors like congestive heart failure, COPD, diabetes mellitus, chronic liver disease, alcoholism, in this case there is a chance of getting vaccine. So chance there is increased risk of getting this pneumococcal pneumonia, and as a result vaccination is indicated in this patients. And if there is splenectomized patients, always you should give vaccine to the adult who has been splenectomized for two vaccines, that is for two organisms, that is you should give pneumococcal vaccine and you should give Haemophilus influenza vaccine. Okay, then if the patient is with long term health facilities also, you will have to give this pneumococci. Okay, next if you see staphylococcal aureus, if you see this staphylococcal aureus, the main this is the complication of measles and influenza. Here there is nematocele formation. What happens is there is first formation of the staphylococcal abscesses are formed. These abscesses will erode the pericardium. Okay, and it results in purulent pericardium. Okay, this purulent pericardium is seen in staphylococcal aureus. It is also common due to it can also lead to empyema in children who are less than 2 years of age. So on diagnosis you can see nematocele in chest x-ray films. So these are important things in staphylococcal aureus, that is post complication of measles and influenza, nematocele formation, purulent pericardium, empyema in children less than 2 years of age, nematocele in x-ray films. Then we have Haemophilus influenza. Haemophilus influenza occurs from 3 months to 3 years of age. It is associated with bacteremia. Okay, it is less common in first 3 to 4 months of life. It is less common because of transplacentally transferred antibodies. Because of that, it is not much common. It is less common in the first 3 to 4 months of life. Okay, then we have the next thing, which is pneumonia due to gram negative bacteria like E. coli or Klebsiella or Pseudomonas. In this, it affects the children who are less than 1 year of age, or if there is malnutrition, or if there is deficient immunity. Okay, if you see Pseudomonas is associated with cystic fibrosis patients. Okay, so this is about the different 4 different organisms which we have seen here. So one is Staphylococcal aureus. Second, we have Haemophilus influenza. Third, we have pneumonia due to gram-negative organisms. Okay. Next, the next thing which is important here is interstitial pneumonia or atypical pneumonia. So here in this interstitial or atypical pneumonia, we have findings which are different from the normal pneumonia. See, in normal pneumonia, you have productive cuff, chest pain will be there. Signs of consolidation are seen in the chest x-ray, and you will also see increased neutrophils and increased macrophages. All the 4 stages of consolidation, all those 4 stages are seen in normal pneumonia. But in interstitial pneumonia, all of them are absent. So there is moderate amount of expectoration is present, and most of the times it is dry cough. And there are no signs of consolidation. There is lymphocytes are increased, and there are no alveolar exudates. So this is the reason why we call it as interstitial pneumonia, because here the inflammation is mainly restricted to the interstitium. This do not respond to any antibiotics. Here there is extra pulmonary manifestations is seen in Legionella in this interstitial pneumonia. So what is the most common organism? Most common organism in interstitial pneumonia is respiratory syncytial virus. It can also occur due to mycoplasma pneumonia or influenza, para-influenza, adenovirus, rhinovirus, cytomegalovirus. This interstitial pneumonia most commonly caused by viruses. And only mycoplasma is the main important bacteria which causes this interstitial pneumonia. Here, as the name says, there is interstitial infiltration, that is inflammation and infiltration is confined to interstitium, that is the spaces between the alveoli, and here this might progress to necrotizing bronchiolitis, where alveolar septa become edematous and bronchus can be inflamed. This can lead to obstruction of terminal bronchioles, leading to emphysema atelectasis. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that first, this is the alveoli. Alveoli are almost normal. These interstitial cells are affected. From these interstitial cells, the infection goes to the bronchioles. Okay, and then as a result, the bronchioles are now undergoes necrosis. Okay, because of the necrosis of bronchioles, they become necrosed and ulcerated. So as a result, these terminal bronchioles are now obstructed. Because of the obstruction of terminal bronchioles, these air spaces which are around, see, these air spaces are normal. These alveoli are normal, right? Almost more or less normal. There will be inflammation, but they are more or less normal. And as a result, this air which is present here will be reabsorbed by the circulation, and it leads to atelectasis. And this type of atelectasis which you are seeing here is called as emphysema atelectasis. Next you see patchy fibrous exudates are also seen. Okay, see, most common cause of pneumonia in infants less than 6 months of age is respiratory syncytial virus. This is important one liner. What is the most common cause of pneumonia in infants less than 6 months of age? That is respiratory syncytial virus. Now we will see a few points about Legionella pneumonia. Legionella pneumonia is caused by Legionella pneumophila, which is gram-negative organism. So what are the predisposing factors? These are most common in impaired host defenses like infection, immunity, immunodeficiency, okay, IV, HIV, or transplantations or corticosteroid therapy. In all these cases where there is immunocompromised states, there is increased chances of increased risk of Legionella pneumonia. Then there can be chronic lung disease, diabetes mellitus, and old age, cigarette smoking, hairy cell leukemia. So all these are the predisposing factors. Actually, in pneumophila, there is no man-to-man spread. The spread is only through air conditioners and aerosols. There is no animal spread also. The main important feature here is extrapulmonary manifestations, where there will be confusion, headache, diarrhea, fatigue, anorexia, and malaise are the features which are seen, which are called as extrapulmonary manifestations of pneumophila. Now, there is one more important thing is hyponatremia is one important laboratory features which is associated with Legionella pneumonia, and drug of choice is azithromycin. So this is about Legionella pneumonia, which is important. Next, the next type of pneumonia is pneumocystis carinii pneumonia. So this pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, it is an opportunistic infection in HIV, immunocompromised like organ transplantation, malnutrition, A-gamma globulinemia. So microscopically, if you see interstitial pneumonitis. Even here, there is immunocompromised state and HIV is the main culprit. Okay, then even here there will be interstitial pneumonia. But here the main important catchy point is pink frothy fluid. Okay, and if you do gomery methanamine silver methanamine stain, you see oval or crescentic cysts with tiny black dot. Oval cysts with black dot is seen like trophozoites. Then the clinical features are almost similar. Chest X-ray shows ground glass appearance. You have already seen that. Then you can do fiber optic bronchoscopy and obtain the biopsy specimen, which is actually diagnostic. Examination for histopathological examination is diagnostic. In pneumocystic pneumonia, the main important thing is trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole is the major drug of choice. Trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole is the drug of choice in pneumocystis pneumonia. Next, we will learn a few points about aspiration pneumonia. So what is aspiration pneumonia? As the name says, here the pneumonia occurs mainly due to the aspiration of either food contents or gastric contents or foreign body or infectious material. What are the factors which will contribute to this aspiration pneumonia? One, unconsciousness or drunkenness, neurological disorders or necrotic oropharyngeal tumors. Whenever the patient is unconscious, obviously the reflexes are blunted, resulting in aspiration pneumonia. In drunkenness, there is relaxation of all the muscles, and you know, he and even here there will be depression of CNS, and as a result the reflexes are not properly appear properly, and as a result there is aspiration pneumonia. In neurological causes, obviously because of the neurological crosses, the reflexes are not seen properly, resulting in aspiration pneumonia. What is the most common cause of aspiration pneumonia? Aspiration pneumonia is most commonly seen in the right lung. Why is it seen in the right lung? Because if you see, the right bronchi is more or less straight when compared to the left bronchi, and as a result the foreign any foreign body or any aspirated material can directly enter the right lung more easier when compared to the left lung. Okay, next we have one more type of pneumonia, which is called as hypostatic pneumonia. Okay, in this hypostatic pneumonia you see collection of edema fluid and secretions which are seen in the dependent parts of the lung. Okay, it is most commonly seen in bedridden patients. Then we have something called as lipid pneumonia. See, lipid pneumonia is, the name says, there is lipid or oily material which is accumulated in the lungs. So it can be either exogenous or endogenous. Exogenous is because of aspiration of oily material, like inhalation of oily nasal drops or oily medication in the stomach which gets aspirated and reaching the lungs. Or it can be endogenous lipid pneumonia, where the tissue breakdown produces lipids which cause obstruction of airways. It is most commonly seen in bronchogenic carcinoma, TB or bronchiectasis. Then these are the all types of lobar pneumonia which we have seen. Now we have to see about two major different types of pneumonia, two types, which are community acquired pneumonia and ventilator associated pneumonia. So first, in the community acquired pneumonia. So this community acquired pneumonia, the outpatients. See, what are the most common causes? What are the causes of community acquired pneumonia? The causes are differentiated whether the patient is an outpatient or whether the patient is hospitalized. See, if the patient is an outpatient, then you can give streptococcus pneumonia. The etiological features can be streptococcus pneumonia, mycoplasma pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza, chlamydia pneumonia, or respiratory syncytial virus. If the patient is hospitalized, then it depends whether the patient is in ICU or non-ICU. If the patient is in ICU, then they can be streptococcus pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza, chlamydia pneumophila, respiratory syncytial virus. See, and if the patient is a non-ICU patient, then the organisms which are implicated are streptococcus pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza, Legionella. See, the way only way to remember all these are, see, streptococcus pneumonia are present in all these. Okay, streptococcus pneumonia is present both in outpatient and also it is present in inpatient also. See, inpatient, outpatient, in hospitalized or outpatient, ICU or non-ICU. Streptococcus pneumonia is one organism, it is present in all. There is one more which is present in all. What is it? Haemophilus influenza is one more which is present in both hospitalized, non-hospitalized, ICUs and non-ICUs. This is one which you have to remember. Second, chlamydia pneumonia is present in both hospitalized, ICU and outpatient. Chlamydia pneumonia is present in ICU and outpatients. Chlamydia pneumonia is present in ICUs and outpatients. Then respiratory virus. Respiratory syncytial virus is also present in ICUs and outpatients. So in ICUs and outpatients, what are present? Chlamydia pneumonia and respiratory syncytial virus, you see, in outpatients and ICU. There is one more. See, this is Legionella. Legionella is present in hospitalized. Legionella is present in hospitalized. So what is only present in outpatient? Mycoplasma pneumonia is only present in outpatients. See how to remember this. This table is from Harrison. Not only this table, the whole matter is from Harrison. So it's better to remember. So in the outpatient and in the hospitalized patients, Streptococcus pneumonia is present in outpatients, hospitalized, ICUs and non-ICUs. Haemophilus influenza and Streptococcus pneumonia are present in hospitalized patients, ICUs, non-ICUs and outpatient patients. Whereas Chlamydia pneumonia and respiratory syncytial virus are present in outpatient and ICU hospitalized. In ICU hospitalized and non-ICU hospitalized, you can see Legionella pneumonia. Mycoplasma pneumonia is present only in outpatient department. See, these are the different factors and organisms which are responsible for the different types of pneumonia. Okay, let us learn them. See, at least one you should remember for sure. If there is alcoholism, most commonly it is seen in it is associated with Streptococcus pneumonia, but it can also be seen in with anaerobes or Klebsiella, Acinetobacter or TB. If it is smoking and COPD, most commonly with Haemophilus influenza and Pseudomonas, also associated with Legionella, Streptococcus, Moraxella, Chlamydia pneumonia. Then, if there is cystic fibrosis and bronchiectasis, in cystic fibrosis and bronchiectasis, it is associated with Pseudomonas aeruginosa followed by Burkholderia sepaceae. Okay, if there is dementia and stroke, this is associated with oral aerobes. If there is decreased level of consciousness, it is associated with gram-negative enteric bacteria. If there is lung abscess, it is associated with CA, MRSA. Okay. If there is aspiration of gastric contents, it is associated with anaerobes. In winter, it is associated with Streptococcus pneumonia. Okay, whenever a person travels to Ohio or St. Lawrence River Valley, it is associated with Histoplasma capsulatum. Whenever the person travels into southwestern US, it is associated with hantavirus. If a person travels with southeastern Asia, it is associated with Burkholderia pseudomallei. If a person stays in a hotel or cruise ship in the previous 2 years, it is associated with Legionella. So these are the organisms. This is very important table because questions are being asked. So next, if there is local influenza activity, then influenza virus is most common. In bats, it is associated with Histoplasma capsulatum. Birds are associated with Chlamydia sittaci. Rabbits are associated with Francisella tularensis. Sheep or goat are associated with Coxiella burnetii. Okay. Even parturient cats are associated with Coxiella burnetii. Now, what is the clinical features? Clinical features are same. The patient suffers with fever, chest pain, tachycardia, productive cough, which has mucopurulent or blood-stinged sputum. And because of the dyspnea, the patient is not able to complete his full sentences. You see pleuritic chest pain, which is sharp pointed, and this chest pain is increased on respiration. In 20% of the cases, there are GI symptoms, which include nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. And if you do examination, you see mediastinum, which is central in position. All the chest wall movements are decreased. You see, on palpation, you can see increased tactile premitus, and on percussion you see dull note, which is seen. On auscultation you can see crackles also. Okay, all these are normal features itself. The main important thing is the color of the sputum. This is very important. See, if there is green colored or yellow colored sputum, it is bacteria because of the enzyme myeloperoxidase, which digests the living tissues, causing this yellowish or greenish colored sputum. Then if it is black colored, it is seen in coal workers' pneumoconiosis. Then, if it is rusty sputum, it is most common in pneumococcal pneumonia. Red currant jelly sputum is common in Klebsiella. Pink frothy sputum is commonly seen in pulmonary edema. Blood stained sputum is commonly seen in pulmonary tuberculosis. Anchovy sauce sputum is seen in amoebic liver abscess. And you will have to see these important things. There are three important things which are seen here. One, we have something called as bronchophony, whispered pectoral echo, and also egophony. okay, you will have to see all the important things about bronchophony, whispered pectoralicu and egophony. Bronchophony is, you will have to ask the person to say 99 in normal voice and then auscultate. If normal words of 99 are heard, then it is normal. But if the words are, see, normal words 99 are heard indistinctly, that means they are not heard properly, then it is normal. If they are heard clearly, then definitely there is a problem. There is pneumonia or there is lung carcinoma. Second, in whispered pectoralicu, you will have to ask the person to whisper the words, that is 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Like that, you should ask him to whisper the words, not say loud. You will have to ask him to whisper him. Then you will have to listen it with the stethoscope. Then if you are not able to hear clear sounds or faint sounds are heard, then it is normal. If you are able to hear the clear sounds, then it can be either pneumonia or it can be either lung carcinoma. Then the next type is egophony. In egophony, you will have to ask the person to say the vowel E and then auscultate. If you auscultate, if E is heard, then it is normal. On auscultation, if you see A, then it is A. A is heard, then it is abnormal. So these are the distinctive features which are seen in pneumonia. That is bronchophony, which is saying 99, whispered pectoralicu, that is whispering 1, 2, 3, and egophony, which is E for E, telling E, the word E. Then you will have to diagnose it. Diagnosis, you can put Gram stain, you can use Gram stain for diagnosis, okay, and you can also do culture of the sputum. And in culture of the sputum should contain 25 neutrophils and less than 10 squamous epithelial cells. The sputum should contain more than 25 neutrophils and less than 10 squamous epithelial cells. And you will have to do blood culture. In blood culture, you see, low yield can occur. This blood culture is mainly done for those people who are in high risk patients. We have already seen high risk conditions like neutropenia, secondary to pneumonia, asplenia, complement deficiency, chronic liver disease, and severe community acquired pneumonia. Then you can do urinary antigen test, can also be done, especially for pneumococcal antigen and legionella antigen serogroup. Then if you see, there are others, like you can do test for legionella, can be done, direct fluorescent antibody test for influenza virus and respiratory syncytial virus can be done. You can do complete blood picture. In complete blood picture, if it's lobar pneumonia, there is increased neutrophils. If it is atypical pneumonia, there is increased lymphocytes are seen. Okay, you can do fluorescent antibody tests are done for influenza and respiratory syncytial virus. PCR is done for legionella and mycobacterium. Obviously, chest x-ray, I have shown you many chest x-rays, right? Then serology, you see increased specificity to IgM antibody titer. Then you have two criteria which are for pneumonia. One, you have pneumonia severity index. This is prognostic model to identify patients at low risk of dying. Okay, then we have CURB 65 also. In CURB 65, this includes confusion, which grade red 1, urea more than 7 millimoles per liter or more than 20 milligram per deciliter, grade red has 1, blood pressure, which is systolic blood pressure less than 90 millimeters of Hg, and diastolic blood pressure less than 60 millimeters of Hg is given the value 1. See, confusion, see, I'll just use other color. Okay, confusion, you were given the number 1. If the urea is more than 7 millimoles per liter or more than 20 milligram per deciliter, the value 1 is given. Systolic blood pressure less than 90 and diastolic blood pressure less than 60, 1 is given. Respiratory rate more than 30, 1. Then age more than 65 years, 1. Total it is 5. Okay, this is CURB 65, which is very important. You should remember this. CURB 65. What are there in CURB 65? Confusion, that is 1. Urea more than 20 milligram per deciliter or more than 7 millimoles per liter, 1 score is given. Systolic blood pressure less than 90, diastolic blood pressure less than 90, score 1 is given. Respiratory rate more than 30, score 1 is given. Age more than 65 years, 1 score is given. Totally we have 5. what is happening in curb score? In curb score, if this curb score is 0.1, then there is low severity and you can treat on OPD basis. If the severity is 2, then you can do moderate severity, then death is 9% and you will have to treat him on inpatient basis. If it is 3 to 5 curb score, then it is high severity, then death is 15 to 40% and you will have to treat him on ICU basis. So how are you going to divide it? Curb 65, if it is 0, no risk, low severity, so as a result outpatient regimen can be given, mortality is 3%. If it is 2 to 3 2 to 2, then only 2, then it is moderate. So in this case you can give inpatient treatment and mortality is 9%. If it is 3 to 5, then it is high severity and 15 to 40%, and ICU treatment should be given. This severity criteria is given by Infectious Diseases Society of America and American Thoracic Society. This is different, fine. Okay, following this, the antibiotics. Antibiotic resistance. Antibiotic resistance for Streptococcus pneumonia resistance, which is DNA incorporation and remodeling. This process of natural transformation shows mutation of genes also. Here, risk factors of Streptococcus pneumonia resistance to penicillin. Recent antimicrobial therapy, age less than, what are the risk factors for this Streptococcus pneumonia resistance to penicillin? That is age more than 65 years or less than 2 years, attendance at daycare clinics or recent hospitalization and HIV infection. So these are the main things which are the risk factors for Streptococcus pneumonia. You should remember these. Then if there is methicillin resistance, then it is most commonly in problem in ribosomal methylation in 23S rRNA by MB gene. If there is fluoroquinolone resistance, it is due to mutation in GRAE and PARC genes. And if there is CA, community acquired MRSA, then mutation is in MECA gene mutation. Okay, this MRSA is susceptible to trimethoprim sulfapyroxazole, clindamycin, tetracycline and vancomycin. Then Enterobacter species are resistant to cephalosporins and the drug of choice of this Enterobacter species is fluoroquinolones or carbapenems. Right. So what are the antibiotic treatment which you should give? So outpatient therapy. In outpatient, no antibiotics are given in the past 3 months. See, in the outpatient therapy, if there is, okay, see, the initial antibiotic treatment, initial antibiotic treatment can be given as uncomplicated therapy, or if the patient is in inpatient non-ICU, or if the patient is in patient ICU. Okay, it differs into 3 parts. Okay, if the patient is in uncomplicated outpatient therapy, then it has 2 things. Sorry, 1, if there are no antibiotics in the past 3 months, or whether the patient has taken antibiotics in the past 3 months, or if there are any comorbidities. So if the patient is uncomplicated outpatient and he has not taken any antibiotics in the past 3 months or there are no comorbidities, then you can give macrolides or clarithromycin or azithromycin, or you can give doxycycline. If there are comorbidities or antibiotics are given in the past 3 months, then you should give fluoroquinolone, moxifloxacin or gemi or levofloxacin, and beta lactams plus macrolides can be given. If inpatient non-ICU patients, then you can give respiratory fluoroquinolones or you can give beta lactams with macrolide. If you give inpatient with ICU, then you should give beta lactam antibiotics plus azithromycin or fluoroquinolone. You should also see special considerations. The special considerations are mainly based on the organism. Okay, also you should defer your treatment. If it is pseudomonas, you should add anti-pseudomonal beta lactams like piperacillin, tazobactam, cefepime, imipenem, meropenem, among all these, one you should select and you should combine it with either ciprofloxacin or levofloxacin. Or you can give beta-lactam antibiotics with aminoglycoside, or you can give all the three, that is beta-lactam antibiotics with aminoglycoside or anti-pneumococcal fluoroquinolones. If it's MRSA, you can give linezolid or vancomycin. If it's VRSA, you can give linezolid alone. That is about community acquired pneumonia. Now let us learn about the last topic, that is ventilator associated pneumonia. So what are you going to see in this ventilator associated pneumonia? See, this ventilator associated pneumonia mostly develops 5 to 7 days of hospital stay. So in the microbiology, if you see, one, non-MDR pathogen, that is non-multi-drug resistant pathogens like Streptococcus pneumonia, Haemophilus influenza, methicillin resistant Staphylococcal aureus, antibiotic resistant Enterobacteriaceae, E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus, Enterobacter and Serratia marcescens. If it is MDR pathogen, then it includes MRSA, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, antibiotic resistant Enterobacteriaceae, Legionella, Burkholderia and Aspergillus. Then what are the pathological mechanisms? So these are the major pathological mechanisms which are seen here. Okay, in ventilation associated pneumonia, this mainly occurs because of the problem in the ventilation apparatus. So like there can be oropharyngeal colonization with pathogenic bacteria can occur. Whenever there is oropharyngeal colonization with pathogenic bacteria, then obviously these pathogenic bacteria grow and they cause ventilation association pneumonia. Now, why is this oropharyngeal colonization? There can be many reasons for it. Among them, first is in ventilator patients who are on ventilator, obviously there will be septicemia. In order to counteract septicemia or to prevent any other infections associated with ICU care, we give antibiotics. These antibiotics will block or they will kill the normal flora which are present in the oropharynx normally. Because of loss of this normal flora, there is increased growth of abnormal flora which should not be present in the oropharynx, leading to oropharyngeal colonization. Then, if there is large oropharyngeal aspiration, even in the presence of aspiration also there is increased chances of getting this infection. And if there is GERD also causes aspiration, leading to the same thing. Then bacterial overgrowth in stomach can also occur. Second, cross infections. Whenever the patient is on ventilator, obviously he should be in ICU care. He should be given ICU care. And in ICU, there will be many patients who have septicemia and septic issues going on their bodies. So as a result, when the healthcare personnel is not careful and does not follow proper hand washing techniques, then obviously there is an increased chance of cross infection from other patients. And then if you do endotracheal intubation or large volume aspirations, even then there is increased chances of this ventilator associated pneumonia. There can be micro aspirations associated with it, or if there are altered respiratory tract defenses, even in them then there is increased chances of ventilator associated pneumonia. Clinical features are similar to any type of pneumonia which we have seen till now, and here you will have to find the causative organism. For that you should do Gram stain, differential counts, all these are same, but the only important thing is detection of local levels of proteins should be detected. Are there any levels of proteins that should be detected? And second, you should also detect Achilles heel. A quantitative approach for antibiotic therapy, there is something called as Achilles heel of quantitative approach which is done for antibiotic therapy also. Then so before we go into the treatment, so first we will see the clinical approach. So in the clinical approach we have, this is the grading which we give. So this clinical approach also you should remember. If there is fever and if it is normal, it is 1. If it is abnormal, either it is more than 39 or less than 36, then it is given the score 2. Then if leukocytosis are less than 4000 to 11000, it is given the score 1. If band cells are more than 50%, they are given the score 1. Then if oxygenation, partial pressure of oxygen by FiO2 is less than 250, we give the score 2. chest x-ray. If there are local infiltrate, the score is 1. If there are patchy or diffuse infiltrate, score is 1. If there is progression of infiltrate, then score is 2. Then, if there is tracheal aspirate, if this tracheal aspirate is heavy, you give score 1. If this tracheal aspirate has same morphology or gram stain, we give score 1. This is very important. Okay, in order to make it even more good, I'll just replace it with this color. If there is fever, so what are the main components? Fever, leukocytosis, oxygenation, chest x-ray, tracheal aspirate. So these are the main components. What are they? Fever, leukocytosis, oxygenation, chest x-ray and tracheal aspirate. So let me tell you again. So in the clinical approach, we have 5 major components. One, we have fever. We have 5 major components. Among them, one, we have fever, then leukocytosis, then chest x-ray, oxygenation, tracheal aspirate. If fever, if the temperature is normal, it is normal. If the fever is more than 39, or if the temperature is more than 39 or less than 36 degrees Celsius, it is given score 1. Then leukocytosis, if there are increased leukocytes more than 11,000 or decreased leukocytes, that is less than 4,000, in both the cases you give the score 1. Or if there are any band forms, you give the score 1. Then partial pressure of oxygen, if partial pressure of oxygen by functional inspiratory oxygen value is less than 250, then you give the score 2. If there are no acute respiratory distress syndrome, even then you give the score 2. Then chest x-ray, if there is local infiltration, you give the score 2. If there is patchy or diffuse infiltration, then you give the score 1. If there is progression of infiltration, then you give the score 2. Then if there is tracheal aspirate, heavy growth, you give the score 1. If there is same morphology on gram stain, you give the score 1. Overall, you give the score 12. Then now first we will see empirical antibiotic therapy. So in the empirical antibiotic therapy, first you will classify the patients into two types. One, patients with risk factors of MDR, or patients at high risk for MDR pathogen. If the patients are at increased risk factors for MDR, then you can give ceftriaxone, ciprofloxacin, moxifloxacin, levofloxacin, amphicillin, salbactam or ertapenem. If the patient is at high risk of developing MDR treatment, then first line MDR pathogen, then first line is beta-lactam agents are given with ceftazidime, cefepim or piperacillin plus tazobactam or imipenem or meropenem. Second line agents include amikacin, gentamicin, ciprofloxacin, levofloxacin. Third line agents include active agents against gram positive like linozolid and vancomycin. So there is nothing to explain here. You will have to remember all these drugs. So these complications are very important. See, why do you get these complications? It's simple. There is infection. So see, all these are related to infections. There is infection, so definitely all these are related to infections. See, infection of lung can lead to XC. I'll just explain you each and everything why all these will happen. So this is the lungs, right? Now you have some infection or consolidation which is occurring in the lung. So because of this consolidation or infection, there will be formation of exudates, right? And these exudates will also reach the, they will cross the membrane and they will reach the pleural space and gets accumulated in the pleural space. This leads to pleural effusion, number one. Number two, this pneumonia which is there, this undergoes necrosis causing necrotizing pneumonia, okay? Number three, then we have this pneumonia consolidation, okay? There occurs fibrosis which occurs around the pneumonia. You see the fibrosis occurring around the pneumonia thing, and this leads to the formation of something called as lung abscess because of the fibrosis, and that is called as lung abscess or empyema, where there is pus or necrotic material in between surrounded by the fibrosis. Okay, what are the uncommon complications? This infection can disseminate to other organs, and it can disseminate to the joints causing septic arthritis. It can disseminate to the heart causing endocarditis. It can also disseminate to the bone causing osteomyelitis, or it can disseminate to the meninges, okay, causing meningitis. So all these are the complications due to dissemination. Okay, it can also cause mechanical ventilation leading to acute respiratory distress syndrome. So it can lead to sepsis. So you have pleural effusion, necrotizing pneumonia, lung abscess, septic arthritis, endocarditis, osteomyelitis and meningitis. All these are complications due to any type of pneumonia. Then last thing is, this is the last thing, which is acute respiratory tract control program. This is pediatric based with the help of this acute respiratory control program. It is mainly for the babies between 2 months to 5 years of age. Here you divide the remedies as 4 major types. Here you divide the babies into no pneumonia, if they do not have any pneumonia, or you can call them as pneumonia, severe pneumonia, or very severe pneumonia. Okay, no pneumonia, severe pneumonia, pneumonia, very severe pneumonia. So if there is no pneumonia, okay, what is seen if there is no pneumonia? If there is no pneumonia, only positive symptom is cough and cold. So you should treat at home itself with home remedies. Everything is, nothing is there except cough and cold, there is nothing. Okay, that is no pneumonia. For pneumonia, there is increased respiratory rate. That is, if the child is less than 2 months, there is that respiratory rate is more than 60 per minute. If the child is 2 to 1 year, the respiratory rate is more than 50 per minute. If the child is 1 to 5 years, then respiratory rate is more than 40 per minute. And here you should give oral cotrimoxazole or amoxicillin. You should give oral cotrimoxazole and amoxicillin for 5 days. Even this is done at home. Then in severe pneumonia, all these cough, cold and increased respiratory rate, along with that there is chest introing, then we call it as severe pneumonia. In this you should give IM or IV penicillin should be given. If there is very severe pneumonia, in very severe pneumonia there will be cyanosis, severe chest introing will already be there, and there will be inability to feed. Cyanosis with inability to feed along with cough, increased respiratory rate and chest indrawing, we call it as very severe pneumonia. Here we give everything in IV penicillin and gentamicin should be given. So when do we call severe disease? In children less than 2 months of age, if there is convulsions or abnormal sleepy, if the child is abnormally sleepy, if there is difficult to wake up, or if there is stridor in children, wheeze, not feeding well, tachypnea or chest indrawing, altered sensorium or central cyanosis, grunting or apneic spells, or distended abdomen. All these will cause severe disease, and in all these also you can give IV ampicillin plus gentamicin. So this is everything about pneumonia from A to Z. I have covered pneumonia in pathology, I have covered pneumonia in medicine, I have covered pneumonia in pediatrics also. Okay, so I think you got something about it. I have involved all the radiological features, histological features and patient's pictures also in this thing. Everything is from 3 main books. One, the pictures are from Netters, then the next pictures are from Robbins, all the theory is from mainly Harrison. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. Thank you.